Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Build, The Power of Hip-Hop Diplomacy in a Divided World, by Mark Katz. Read by Michael Butler Murray. About the companion website. Build's companion website, www.oup.com/us/build, provides a wide variety of materials related to this book. A chapter-by-chapter companion offers photos, maps, text, and videos related to subjects and issues discussed throughout the book. Other supplemental materials include interview transcripts with artists, educators, State Department personnel, and others, as well as links to additional resources. The website will be updated regularly. Introduction. Queens Community House, New York, July 2016. Frankie Perez brought his friend, Mark Kawisi, to dance practice. They were so welcoming, Mark fondly says of his time with Frankie's crew, supreme beings. As Frankie remembers, "We were practicing together, not really saying much because we were focused on our training. It was beautiful." The two breakdancers, or B-boys, both in their mid-20s, were doing more than just honing their moves that hot summer day. They were learning from each other and about each other. In hip-hop terms, they were building together. A decade earlier, Mark Kawisi was an orphan living on the streets of Kampala, Uganda. He was ambitious. "I always wanted to focus on something bigger, on something greater," he explains. "I never wanted to accept that I was a failure." For a while, soccer seemed like a way out, but he couldn't afford the bribes necessary to secure a place on a traveling team. International aid organizations offered assistance, but Mark only felt exploited. "They take these photos of you when you're standing in garbage in the street. Then they buy you a plate of food from the thousands of dollars they get from donations instead of implementing programs that would help." At the time, Mark was making no more than 50 cents a day, fetching water and hauling trash. He then learned about Breakdance Project Uganda, BPU, founded by another Kampala orphan, Tekya Abrams Abraham. Mark had always loved hip-hop dance and was thrilled to take the free classes. BPU wanted something in return, however. "They told me, in this organization, the only thing we expect you to do is to teach others for free." So whenever he learned a new move, he would teach it to someone. It didn't matter that Mark was a beginner, and it didn't matter whom he taught. His only instructions were, "Whoever wants to learn something, please do teach them." It was 2008, and Mark, now 18 years old, had a profound realization. "Guess what? I'm a teacher now," he recalls with wonder. And with this revelation came a sense of purpose. "I found a place of belonging. I found a place where I was being appreciated." An excellent instructor, he started getting paid gigs, a workshop here and there at a local school or prison. He took a course on creative facilitation and developed a distinctive pedagogy for teaching children. Some of the prominent international schools in Uganda, which he could never have afforded to attend, started hiring him to teach dance classes. Mark was no longer homeless and was supporting himself through the two things he loved most, dancing and teaching. 7,000 miles to the west in New York, Frankie Perez was also finding salvation in hip-hop dance, or as he refers to it, breaking. "Breaking really helped me get out of trouble during those teenage years," he attests. "A lot of the friends I had were in gangs. Even in eighth grade, I had friends who were selling drugs. That could have easily been my path, too. But the hip-hop community helped me stay out of it." He joined a dance crew and started to win competitions or battles. Through battling, he built his reputation, refined his craft, and launched a career that would take him around the world. One of his travels led him to Uganda and to Mark Kawisi. Their paths first crossed in June 2015, when Frankie led a dance workshop for 2 weeks in Kampala hosted by Breakdance Project Uganda. The two men hit it off, quickly earning each other's respect. "The connection can be a deep one," Frankie says, "because we're relating over something that we spent so much time and energy doing. That's the connection that I can have with somebody coming from a place like Uganda, while I grew up in New York City." Their connection lasted beyond those 2 weeks in Kampala. A year later, Mark left Africa for the first time. The recipient of a prestigious Mandela Washington Fellowship, he spent 6 weeks in an intensive professional development program at Wagner College, just 20 miles from the community center where Frankie's crew practiced. Their reunion, Frankie explained, wasn't a one-off thing. When we met in Uganda, it was the start of a relationship, and when we met in New York, it just showed that we're going to continue working together. This relationship, a friendship born out of hip-hop, was made possible by the United States Department of State. Frankie's visit to Uganda was sponsored by a State Department-sponsored initiative called Next Level, a program I directed from 2013 to 2018. Next Level is an international exchange program that sends teams of U.S. hip-hop artists to work with youth in undeserved communities around the world, and subsequently brings representatives from each country it visits to the United States for artistic and professional training. It is a form of people-to-people diplomacy, where private citizens of different nations come together to seek common ground and forge mutual understanding. More specifically, it is a form of cultural diplomacy, where a state's arts, cuisine, literature, and the like provide the platform for people-to-people interactions. Richard T. Arndt, a veteran of U.S. cultural diplomacy programs, described the purpose of this work. "Quietly, invisibly, indirectly, my cultural colleagues and I spent our lives representing American education and intellect, art and thought, setting foreign ideas about America into deeper contexts, helping others understand the workings of the peculiar U.S. version of democracy, combating anti-Americanism and its taproots, linking Americans and foreign counterparts, helping the best American and foreign students study somewhere else. In short, projecting America, warts and all." Here, the culture in question is hip-hop. Thus the term, hip-hop diplomacy. Hip-hop diplomacy dates only to the early years of the 21st century, but it is part of the U.S. government's decades-long deployment of the arts in international relations, a descendant of the famous jazz tours that sent the likes of Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington around the world in the 1950s and 1960s. The jazz tours of the 20th century and the hip-hop workshops of the 21st, as well as other exchanges, like the Fulbright Program, are products of the State Department's Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, or ECA. Its mission? To increase mutual understanding between the people of the United States and the people of other countries by means of educational and cultural exchange that assist in the development of peaceful relations. The partnership between hip-hop and the U.S. government is an unlikely one. The dissonance is obvious. Hip-hop is celebrated for its oppositional stance, especially against the U.S. government, which has marginalized and oppressed the communities who created this art and culture. Look no further than Public Enemy's iconic song, Fight the Power, and its anti-authority position explicit in its lyrics and in the group's name. And diplomatic is hardly the first word associated with hip-hop. Countless hip-hop songs celebrate or spotlight crime, misogyny, and violence, none of them consistent with the image and messaging the State Department seeks to project abroad. To supporters and critics of the music and culture, the very idea of hip-hop diplomacy can be deeply troubling, even an oxymoron. The risks inherent in hip-hop diplomacy arise from the inescapable fact that diplomacy is ultimately intended to serve state interests. For some critics, hip-hop poorly represents the United States. For others, cultural diplomacy exploits hip-hop. Taking the former perspective, political scientist Michael Curtis has questioned the State Department's use of rappers in its diplomatic efforts, arguing that their lyrics do not posit a peaceful or democratic future and are unlikely to help change perceptions of the U.S. Their performers are not the standard bearers of nonviolent behavior or of tolerance, nor are they useful in illustrating the diversity of American life. Anthropologist Suad Abdul Kabir has criticized hip-hop diplomacy from a very different perspective, identifying it as part of the U.S. government's management of an imperial relationship with the Muslim world in the post-9/11 era. As an effect of power, she asserts, the low-impact cultural diplomacy strategy must be seen in aggregate. Multiple low-impact events, small inputs, and each tidbit of information are pooled to spin a particular narrative of American exceptionalism in order to justify U.S. empire. Both perspectives must be taken seriously. Misrepresentation and co-optation are ever-present risks of state-sponsored people-to-people exchanges. But we must also beware of false equivalencies. Hip-hop is more than the collection of words and images associated with certain popular artists. Diplomacy cannot be reduced to a tool whose sole function is to advance state power and expand empire. There is no singular U.S. government agenda, or State Department agenda, or even ECA agenda. The bureaucracies that execute U.S. foreign policy are never wholly unified. They are complex and opaque, guided by ever-evolving and sometimes contradictory pressures, peopled by foreign service officers, civil servants, and contractors who, on a daily basis, work to transform chaos into some semblance of order. Just as any fair assessment of hip-hop diplomacy must take a skeptical stance, it must also account for the agency and creativity of the U.S. artists who have embraced this work. Among them, well-respected activists and educators, underground legends, pioneers, and Grammy winners, as well as the thousands of artists and fans that hip-hop diplomacy touches around the world. Agency, of course, must be understood in the context of broader economic, political, and social structures. In this book, I toggle between structure and agency, examining the broad forces that shape individual action, as well as the individuals who shape the world around them. But let me be clear about my focus and my sympathies and biases. More than anything, Build is about those who seek self-expression and community through hip-hop. Their work reveals an unresolvable tension, one that animates this book, that just as hip-hop and hip-hop diplomacy can bridge cultural divides, facilitate understanding, and build community, it can also be misused, exploited, and hurt those it is meant to help. To explore this tension is to probe the multifaceted power of art, and thus to gain insight into its significance in international relations and human affairs. Why hip-hop? For Mark Kawisi and Frankie Perez, hip-hop was a lifesaver. "Hip-hop saved my life" is a phrase uttered in dozens of languages across the world. It's often said quite literally that hip-hop offered an alternative to addiction, crime, poverty, or despair. As a teenager in the Rio de Janeiro favela, known as Cidade de Deus, City of God, Rafaela Romualdo left home to escape an abusive stepfather, but soon fell into the drug trade. She doubts she would have survived much longer had she not found hip-hop, which gave her life direction and meaning. When I walked with Rafaela, now a well-regarded rapper, through the streets of the City of God, we passed a young man spray-painting, "O hip-hop me edusau," hip-hop educated or raised me, on an empty wall next to a church. The graffito captured her truth as well as his. She later wrote to me, "Hip-hop is the guiding thread of a light that rescues young people from crime and makes them think that through culture, there is a way out." Hip-hop was also a way out for Detroit rapper D'Essence, a way to escape the discrimination and hardship she endured because of her bisexuality. I'd been ostracized by friends, family alike. I faced homelessness. And even in that period of homelessness, that dark season, what kept me optimistic was the art form of rhyming and hip-hop, the genre itself. I won't say that I saw the light at the end of the tunnel, but I knew that at least I'd shovel my way into it until I could see it. And that's what hip-hop has given me, tenacity. To many, hip-hop is not just a lifesaver. It is their life. Conscience, the MC, a rapper from Washington, D.C., put it this way. To me, hip-hop isn't just b-boying and DJing and rapping and doing graffiti. Hip-hop is truly a culture. It's truly a way of life. Hip-hop is what raised me, outside of my mom's house. When I walk to the corner store to get a pack of backwoods cigars, that's hip-hop. The way I dress is hip-hop. The way I greet my homeboys up the street is hip-hop. The stories that we tell each other, the way we tell them, that's hip-hop. And when Conscience speaks of hip-hop raising him, of it being at the center of his culture, his fashion, and his stories, he's invoking hip-hop's power to build community. And part of the power of hip-hop diplomacy, perhaps its most important power, is the possibility of fostering global community. Hip-hop is perhaps the most listened-to musical genre on Earth. What is it about hip-hop that draws and connects people like Mark Kowisi and Frankie Perez, or that raises, educates, and saves the lives of Raffaella Romualdo, D'Essence, and Conscience? Broadly speaking, three factors help explain its massive global popularity: its flexibility, its accessibility, and its mythology. By flexibility, I mean its expressive flexibility, its ability to create, incorporate, and generate sound and sense in infinite variety. Typically, hip-hop fans are most immediately drawn to the music's beats and rhymes. The interplay between percussion and poetry can serve as a vehicle for fierce braggadocio, tender expressions of love, and everything in between. The beats, typically created by DJs or beatmakers, also known as producers, and the rhymes, created by rappers, also known as MCs, are only part of hip-hop's appeal. Beatboxing, a form of vocal percussion that draws on DJing and beatmaking for its sonic vocabulary, is popular the world over. But hip-hop is not just about sound. It has the visual element of graffiti art or writing, as many of its practitioners call it, with an array of styles and a distinctive history. And then there is the element of dance. Hip-hop originated out of the relationship between DJs and dancers, as DJs discovered that repeating or looping short percussion solos, known as breaks, helped foster a new dance style that came to be known popularly as breakdancing. Though many practitioners refer to it as breaking or b-boying or b-girling, these elements have been remixed by artistic communities around the world. I've heard MCs spit rhymes in Arabic, Burmese, and Croatian, as well as Swahili, Thai, and Uzbek. And this is just a fraction of the world's languages that have wrapped their tongues around hip-hop. From the beginning, hip-hop drew not just from funk and soul for its beats, but from a variety of world traditions, from Afrobeat to salsa. And as hip-hop spread beyond the United States, it adapted itself to local music and dance styles and indigenous instruments. Just in my own experience, I've encountered Bengali baul, Colombian cumbia, Nubian funk, Serbian turbo folk, and more, mixed beautifully with hip-hop beats and bars. This expressive flexibility helps account for hip-hop's global spread. Another aspect of hip-hop's appeal is its accessibility. Only a body and a voice are needed to rap, beatbox, or dance. Graffiti art requires materials, but artists can make do with whatever is at hand. Even DJing and beatmaking, which typically demand laptops, software, drum machines, or other gear, have become more accessible since the turn of the millennium as equipment has become cheaper, more portable, and more robust. Hip-hop can also be accessible to disabled people who accommodate hip-hop to their bodies and needs. For Brazilian b-boy Samuka, who lost a leg to cancer as a child, excelling as a dancer allowed him to feel normal as a teenager, equal to his peers. Samuka met legendary U.S. b-boy Cujo during a next-level residency in 2017. Cujo, who is deaf, brought Samuka into his renowned international dance crew, Ill Abilities. According to its website, the ill in Ill Abilities does not refer to sick or unwell, but rather to incredible, amazing, intricate, talent. Rather than seeing the negative limitations of disability, this crew focuses on their positive, or ill, abilities. Soon Samuka, who had never traveled outside of Brazil, was performing in the United States, France, and Singapore, often sporting a t-shirt with the crew's motto, "No excuses, no limits." For him, hip-hop was both salvation and passport. Hip-hop is also accessible in that it's easy to find, especially in mediatized form. Recordings and radio have been spreading the music for decades, but the culture has been disseminated most powerfully via Hollywood, through movies like Wild Style, 1983, Breakin', 1984, Beat Street, 1984, House Party, 1990, and Juice, 1992. Brothers Akim and Dumasani Ndlovu, a.k.a. Akim Funk Buddha and Do Me Right, fondly remember the impact of seeing Beat Street as teenagers when it first screened in Harare, Zimbabwe. As Dumi explains, "We were so amped, in fact, that we paid to see it multiple times in the theater, and after each showing we'd hang around and then start a dance cipher, improvised performance, as patrons exited, often to resounding applause. Initially, the theater owners tried to chase us out as troublemakers. Upon seeing the crowds react, though, they ended up inviting us back and giving us free movie tickets to come perform officially at future screenings." The video cassette then opened up the possibility of studying hip-hop outside the United States. Many international hip-hop artists recall how, as youth in the 1980s and 1990s, and into the 2000s, they watched tapes of these films over and again, often in groups of friends around the one VCR available in their community. For countless artists, these films were their hip-hop primers. Others encountered hip-hop for the first time through music videos, whether on TV or tape. In the film Slingshot Hip-Hop, Palestinian MC Suel Nafar of the group Dam recounts the impact of seeing the 1993 video of Tupac Shakur's "Holler If You Hear Me." "It looked like he filmed it in our hometown Lode. Even though we didn't know English and we didn't get the lyrics, we made the connection." Tamer, Suel's older brother and a member of Dam, got all the Tupac tracks he could find and learned English by sitting at the back of the class, translating the lyrics into Arabic and sharing them with me. Then came the digital revolution of the 2000s, allowing hip-hop to become truly global. File-sharing networks like Napster allowed music to circulate outside corporate control and gave unprecedented access to hip-hop fans and creators. In just a few years, the media landscape changed again with the rise of Facebook, 2004, YouTube, 2005, SoundCloud, 2007, Spotify, 2008, WhatsApp, 2009, and Instagram, 2010. Platforms that gave fans and practitioners new ways to see and hear hip-hop and to connect with like-minded souls, whether locally or across vast distances. A third reason for hip-hop's global appeal is its powerful mythos. Hip-hop has a potent origin story. In the 1970s, talented, industrious African-Americans and Latinx teenagers in the Bronx, New York, developed a new art form and culture, one that went on to become a globally influential industry and way of life. Grand Wizard Theodore, the pioneering Bronx DJ who introduced the world to scratching, put it this way: "Hip-hop came from nothing. The people that created hip-hop had nothing, And what they did was they created something from nothing. To hip-hop artists around the world, the Bronx is a name uttered with reverence, and the concept of creating something from nothing resonates profoundly. When I asked a 20-year-old white Croatian dancer named Eva what appealed to her about hip-hop, she immediately invoked the Bronx and the pioneering dance group Rock Steady Crew. Hip-hop began in the Bronx. Zagreb is the farthest from the Bronx, but right now, okay, with the economy and our situation politically, we feel the same they felt in the early 80s and 70s. It's really hard to find a job. It's really hard to live as an artist. You really have to bleed for that status. Rocksteady didn't have money. They didn't have studios. They just had their own imaginations, and that got them through dark times. And that's how we feel here. A rapper, entrepreneur, and hip-hop activist, known as ABD, once suggested his own hip-hop myth. I think of hip-hop as this superhero. Well, he got no capes and stuff. He's just one of those boombox on his shoulder flying across the world superheroes. Oh, there's a struggle over there. I'ma go there. I'm gonna spread myself out to the people and uplift them and show them how to come together through positivity and love. That's how I think of hip-hop. A rapper from the United States could well have told this story, but I spoke with ABD in his hometown of Dhaka, Bangladesh, and our conversation took place within a distinctive soundscape of quarreling car horns, clanging rickshaw bells, and the Muslim call to prayer. It didn't matter that he was born 7,800 miles from the birthplace of hip-hop. "There's a reason hip-hop has spread so fast, so far," he explained. "Hip-hop to me is directly related to struggle. It would have not been born if there was no struggle. We have so much poverty over here. Hip-hop is just a form of self-expression that is relevant to the Bangla youth." ABD's government name is Mohammed Abdullah. In the 21st century, there is nothing strange about a Bangladeshi Muslim named Mohammed who is familiar with African-American vernacular English and hip-hop style, with 150 million people sharing his name and its variants. There are almost certainly more rappers named Mohammed than Mike. Look at the list of 195 countries recognized by the United Nations and try to find a country where hip-hop doesn't have a presence. It's in Afghanistan, where MCs have made news rapping about the Taliban and forced marriage. And it's in Zimbabwe, where an initiative called Step Up to HIV uses hip-hop dance to educate young people in the hopes of achieving an AIDS-free generation. It's in Venezuela, where rappers Apache and Cancerbero took on police corruption in their rhymes. And it's in the archipelagic South Pacific nation of Vanuatu, where a DJ and producer known as Local Remedy has used his music to address poverty and hunger among the island's villages. Local Remedy is an apt name. Hip-hop is widely and rightly recognized as a product of black culture. It arose in response to the particular lived experience of black youth in New York in the 1970s and 1980s. Yet from the beginning, hip-hop has exerted a powerful pull on people who are not black and whose histories and traditions are very different from those of hip-hop's pioneers. The worldwide spread of hip-hop serves as a fascinating example of globalization. Originating from an economic and cultural superpower, hip-hop has clearly become a commodity, generating billions of dollars. And yet, it is not the homogenizing force that one might expect, one that necessarily de-emphasizes the local or encourages conformity to a U.S. model. ABD, for example, says that hip-hop can be as Bangladeshi as it is American. Referring to a massive hip-hop concert in Dhaka on November 17, 2014, he wrote in a Facebook post, "What happened on the 17th was more than fusion. It was embracing hip-hop in Bangladesh." Hip-hop music thrives on samples of historic blues, soul, funk, and jazz artists. We as Bangladeshis sampled our poets Nazrul, Qazi Nazrul Islam, and Lalan, and more, to create hip-hop with their blessings and energy. This was hip-hop adopting to Bangladeshi culture. Suad Abdul Kabir perceptively captures the complexity of hip-hop as a global cultural product when she describes it as a traded commodity and an oppositional culture at the same time. Hip-hop diplomacy embodies this tension, where practitioners may fight the power and serve it simultaneously. The power of hip-hop diplomacy. It's not hard to understand why the U.S. State Department would take an interest in hip-hop. Here is an art form that is readily identified as American, but at the same time has been embraced by communities around the world. Hip-hop is thus well-suited to connect citizens of the United States with the citizens of other countries, acting as a goodwill ambassador without carrying the taint of U.S. imperialism. Moreover, hip-hop resonates deeply with youth, the fastest-growing segment of the global population, and a demographic any state ignores at its peril. Still, it might not be obvious what foreign policy objectives hip-hop diplomacy serves. I would point to two: enhancing the image of the United States and promoting U.S. interests abroad. People-to-people diplomacy, including hip-hop diplomacy, is a form of public relations conducted largely in private and on a small scale. The State Department sees great value in getting U.S. citizens on the ground, interacting with their counterparts around the world. The story of Mark Kawisi and Frankie Perez reveals people-to-people diplomacy at work. Their friendship made them question the caricatures and stereotypes that represent their countries to the outside world. Mark's experience challenged the view of Americans as proud and arrogant, one he says is common in Uganda. America is not one person, he realized. It's different people that have different mentalities, that have different ambitions, that have different opinions. And because young people all over the world embrace the music and culture, hip-hop diplomacy in particular, has the potential not just to challenge assumptions, but to generate positive associations with the country of its birth. When I asked Siri Panda Kelly, a Malagasy beatboxer, MC, and producer, to describe his image of the United States, he answered without hesitation, "The country of hip-hop, the country of liberty, the country where you can realize your dreams. This is my image of U.S." Public relations can also be an explicit form of damage control. When Next Level visited Belgrade in 2014, the U.S.-led NATO bombing of Serbia in 1999 was still a raw wound. I witnessed this in my first minutes in the country, when a taxi driver learned that I was from the United States, looked at me in the rearview mirror, and said with disgust, "I don't like Bill Clinton." Maria Bielopetrovic, the cultural affairs assistant at the U.S. Embassy in Belgrade, explained that having U.S. hip-hop artists lead workshops for Serbian youth helped address this festering resentment. Serbia still has negative feelings towards the United States because of the bombing during NATO time. It's important that kids and the general population can actually be in contact with the Americans to see that, you know, they're normal people, that they're not these fanatics, that they're not cops that are running the entire world, and so on, that they're just general everyday people who laugh and have fun and enjoy life, and so on. A lot of Serbians have never communicated with an American before, so do us. That really helps the embassy build a better image. Just a year earlier, the Serbian public approval rating of the United States was only 9%. At the time we spoke, it had more than doubled to 20%, an outcome that Bielopetrovic attributed to intensive engagement. The State Department has likewise turned to hip-hop as a means to improve the country's image abroad with Muslim populations, where approval ratings for the United States often range from poor to abysmal. This kind of attention to image is hardly superficial. For when it comes to international relations, a nation's reputation can make the difference between cooperation and conflict with other states. Cultural diplomacy can also help advance particular interests of the United States abroad. Every U.S. diplomatic post in the world works to promote certain priorities in its country. The embassy in Brazil has 6: education, social inclusion, trade and investment, democracy and human rights, peace and security, and science, technology, and innovation. and every post activity is meant to support one or more of them. When Next Level visited Brasilia and Rio de Janeiro in 2017, the embassy and consulate were eager to promote social inclusion by working with youth in communities that have been underserved, sometimes quite literally marginalized. Social inclusion also meant offering opportunities to young Brazilians with disabilities. And although it wasn't planned this way, the U.S. team included beatmaker King Chasm, who uses a wheelchair, and b-boy Cujo, who is deaf. The example of Samuka, the dancer Cujo met in Brasilia and later invited into his crew, Ill Abilities, offered a perfect example of how the program could, as the embassy's website articulates, empower marginalized people to take advantage of burgeoning global opportunities and enjoy equal access to markets, services, and political, social, and physical spaces. Social inclusion was also a priority for the U.S. Embassy in the small Balkan country of Montenegro, where we worked with the historically marginalized Roma population, and particularly with Roma women, a doubly oppressed population. Cultural Affairs Officer Sunshine Eisen cited the presence of three American women, MC Mahogany Jones and dancers Dina Clemente and Wandy Candelario, as essential to our work. Having these amazing, strong hip-hop artists who are women, she told me, show that it's okay to practice your art, that it's okay to be a woman and be strong, that you have a right to choose your destiny, and that you have a right to talk about the issues that are important to you. Fostering conflict resolution is also a common priority among U.S. diplomatic posts. When in 2013, the State Department's Cultural Programs Division put out the call to nonprofit organizations to create what would become Next Level, conflict resolution was a central theme. The purpose of the program would be to develop and administer an international exchange program in hip-hop and urban arts that incorporates artistic collaboration, professional development, and outreach to youth to explore and address conflict resolution strategies. For countless young people, hip-hop has served as a means to find alternatives to the conflicts that swirl around them and to transform the conflict that churns inside them. Hip-hop diplomacy, then, offers the possibility of transforming conflict through cross-cultural performance and collaboration. Building. In hip-hop culture, to build is to elevate, to add positivity to the world. To build with someone is to collaborate, to work towards something that can be achieved collectively, but not individually. This notion of building can be traced to the teachings of the 5% Nation, a cultural and spiritual movement that emerged in New York City and has shaped hip-hop since its beginnings. Today, the English word build and its hip-hop definition are known all over the world. In fact, this book's title was inspired by an artist I met in Zimbabwe during one of the first Next Level residencies. Ngoni Tapiwa, better known as Upmost, told me that he was worried when he learned that a group from the United States was coming to Harare. "I hope these guys don't think they're coming to teach us hip-hop," he recalled thinking. "I hope they're going to learn as well and build with the hip-hop that exists."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.